Hello, welcome to Gardener's World and the Royal Horticultural Society's Morven Spring Festival. Now, the show is celebrating its 30th year this year, and I've been coming to about 25 of them because this is my local show, and we'll be bringing you as much of it as we possibly can, as well as getting behind the scenes and seeing some of the journeys that led to these glorious floral exhibits and show gardens. For me, Morven is a celebration of spring and all the wonderful plants that are daily filling our gardens with more and more colour.
Morven is an absolute magnet for nurseries from all over the country who come here to show us their wares. I can't wait to see what floral delights are in store.
I'm here for the plants too, and I'll be looking for inspiration inside the floral marquee.
And I'll be taking a closer look at the show gardens and some great design ideas you can use at home.
Yesterday, I was lucky enough to get a sneak preview of the floral marquee. It was a hive of activity as the stallholders attempted to create stunning displays to attract the attention of the visitors and, of course, impress the judges. Well, as ever, the floral marquee is packed to the rafters with incredible displays, but this year, some of the stands have really pulled out all the stops. Marcel, your display is the first thing that's caught my eye. I mean, why the ship?
Well, basically, the reason we chose the ship was the first tomatoes came in from Spain back in 1569, and that gave us the inspiration.
I think it's a beautiful way of showing them off. And, of course, people forget that there's a clematis in flower pretty much all year round, isn't there?
Yeah, I mean, they start in December, January with winter beauty going right onto cerosa freckles and loads of clematis in between.
Yes, I love the little coriana there. That's beautiful.
Yeah, Ben's beauty is exquisite, isn't it? And they thrive on neglect, because that's how I like to treat my plants, as you can see.
Nice and easy. Well, I have to say, I'm tempted by that, but I've just spotted Clematis Charlotte, and I think, given the news this week and the new royal baby, it's got to be Charlotte, hasn't it? I mean, will that take a bit of shade?
It's fantastic. Flowers for you in April, May, and again August, September time, but if you give it a bit of shade, that blueness comes right through it.
I know you're setting up now, but would you put one aside for me, and I'll come back tomorrow with my cash and get one of those.
Thank you.
This is such an innovative and colourful display. It's really glorious. And it's celebrating the fact that now so many of us buy our plants mail order. So this is the sort of thing that arrives through the post. And then you get all this colour. It's about the promise of these plants. But also, there are stories here with individual plants. So, for example, we've got a lovely Scilla here, Scilla peruviana. And you'd think with that name that it's come from Peru. In fact, it hasn't. It's come from southern Spain, but it was on a ship called the Peru. Now, it needs a really hot, dry position, and I think I've got the perfect spot for it at home. So, Alan, have you got any of these Scillas here? I know they're mail order as well, but have you got any?
We have just a few in pots on the sales table. If you hurry, I'll save you one.
Fantastic. I'll come back tomorrow morning. Put one aside for me.
Okay.
I won't disturb you anymore, because I know you've got to get on and the judges are coming. When Morven opens its gates to the public, it's clear that I'm not the only one who can't resist the floral delights on display here.
Woo! Look at that. It matches you, You look perfect together. That's beautiful, isn't that lovely? It's a glorious lavender. I've never seen it before.
No, me neither, I've got other lavender, but I just thought that looked so different that it was worth trying
having a go.
Yes.
Where did you get them from?
From the Floral Pavilion.
Well, I'm right on my way there, no. I might be tempted. I'm a bit envious.
Now, it's not just splendid flowers that are attracting people here at Morven. There are also really good show gardens, often made by young designers who go on to become much better known. And I really like this one. It's called The Bee's Knees, and it's focusing on the need of bumblebees in particular and bees and pollinating insects in general, and showing how you really can make a difference on the plants that you choose. You have here Mediterranean herbs, with the lavender at the moment attracting the bees, but very soon when the thyme flowers and rosemary and marjoram, they'll just pull the pollinators in like a magnet. But it doesn't have to be specialised. you can see a wide range of planting, the sort of thing that you would be able to do in any garden anywhere in this country at this time of year, ranging from the alliums to the Sursium revulari. We've got poppies, geums, nepeta, making a lovely jumble of flower. Now, what all these plants share are two characteristics. The first is that they're simple in shape, so that makes them very accessible for the bees. And the second is that they are all rich in pollen and nectar. And some of our plants, particularly the more showy ones, have been bred to such an extent that they've lost the power to make much pollen or nectar. And it's very easy to provide that in the garden, very important too, because our wildflowers are diminishing all the time. So it means that wherever you are, you can make a garden that is attractive to us, but also really attractive to bees too. Show gardens can inform, they can inspire, they can entertain, but whatever you think of them, they all share the same amount of work and skill that it takes just to bring a garden here. And last week, Jo went along to visit a previous gold medalist to see how her preparations for this year's show were going.
I've been following Hannah Gender's gardens for years. Her designs are many and varied, but are always sustainable and wildlife friendly. This year, Hannah's garden will be showcasing a commission she's been developing for a hospice in Hereford, a project she's passionate about. Hi, Hannah.
Oh, hi, Jim.
How are you doing?
I'm fine, very busy.
So tell me about your garden at Malvern this year.
Well, it's a hospice garden. It's for St Michael's Hospice in Hereford. It ticks every box for me.
Yeah.
Because it's sustainable, it's about an eco-build, and of course it's therapeutic.
Fantastic. You know, it's all your passions and strengths.
All my passions and strengths in one garden.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'll show you some designs.
Yeah, I'd love to have a look. So it sounds like there's quite a lot of layers through of the thought process.
I've called it the journey garden. So this path sort of sweeps through all different elements at the hospice. My main structure, Joe, is this massive sculptural tree made out of metal, and that represents the hospice as a sanctuary for people on this journey. And this garden is going to go back there afterwards.
Oh, so it's going to have a life after,
yeah,
just
which
a show.
Is lovely. I wanted to use something in the path that sort of spoke about the fact they've not only got this eco build at the hospice, they're refurbing the old bits. And so we're trying to tell the story of recycling stuff from the old hospice. And came up with this idea of incredibly ugly carpet tiles. This is the effect that you have when you put them in a path.
Oh, yeah. They look really good.
The hospice are trying to get a lot of biodiversity back in, encourage butterflies and bees. And so at the front, I came up with this, at the time, a great idea. To do a no-grass tapestry lawn. It's sort of knitted together ground cover, ajugas and bellis daisies, and probably quite a lot of weeds that you'd normally take out of your lawn. And then they say you can mow it twice a year. Okay. You can have light footfall.
Can you play football on it?
No.
Well, that's not a lawn then.
That's not a lawn.
If you can't play football on it, it's not a lawn.
It's proving to be quite a challenge.
This is also very close to your own heart, isn't it? I mean, you've been through some sort of
Went through a really tough time. Put the design in October, as you do, with a view to starting work on it, you know, the back end of last year. And then my son was very, very ill. And so we spent the whole of Christmas and New Year in and out of the hospital. It brings it home to you, when you're going through really hard times, how incredibly important it is to have things of beauty and a connection with the landscape and the outdoors. And for me, that's always been close to my heart. It's even closer now. So this is where we are. Lovely corner plot.
Yeah, beautiful, isn't it?
These are all the plants that haven't yet gone in. Come and have a look.
Wow, it's more advanced than I thought
it
was going to be. Yeah, you've got plants in.
And this is the path. And that is the carpet tiles packed into the frame.
I think it's a really nice surface.
And then the big space in the middle is where my tree will be. And then the planting at the front.
Ah, yes, your tapestry lawn.
My tapestry lawn.
Which is looking great. How long ago did you plant this then?
We planted that last week because I don't want it to look newly planted. I want it to try and knit in a bit and look like it's been here for a while.
So what do you want the visitors who see this garden to take away from it?
I really hope they'll get the sense of journey that this is a sanctuary space. I hope they'll love it and discuss my tapestry lawn.
The tapestry lawn's definitely going to get discussed. Yeah. We'll discuss for many years to come.
Yeah.
Good luck with it.
Thank you.
How? Here we are. The sun's come out. Yeah. This is the finished garden. This is some structure.
This is the tree. Isn't it fantastic?
It's quite amazing. Yeah. Standing underneath it, it gives that feeling of protection and security.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what it's all about.
You know, my favourite part of the whole garden?
Yeah.
These benches.
Aren't they wonderful?
They are beautiful. Mm, yeah. And, of course, they're very good for biodiversity, aren't they?
Mm. Well, because bees and everything can get into there. So we've got all sorts of things in there, carpet tiles and bits from the hospice and bamboo and...
Yeah, well, you've got to use carpet tiles. They're everywhere else in the garden,
yeah,
after all.
Yeah, yeah.
So what medal did you get?
We got silver gilt. So we are just off of gold.
And how do you feel about that?
I feel a little bit disappointed. I mean, for me, this is the best garden I've ever done.
Yeah.
So for me, it was a gold. And you have to go for gold, whether you get it or not. And the first garden I ever got, I got silver gilt, so that's another one to add to the collection.
Ah, good, and there's going to be one more. I can tell, last time you said this is going to be my last show garden ever, but now you're thinking again. Lovely to see you, Hannah.
And you, thank you so much,
I'll see you around.
Thank you.
Good design makes sense of any garden, but especially in a small space, it's going to earn its keep. This garden's called Cornerstone, and I really like the way it's built on a split level. So here we've got a sunken garden, which means that the plants around the outside are brought up to eye level, and you feel completely enveloped in them. It creates that sense of privacy, which is important. Now, where do you put your shed in a small garden? There's always storage issues, but here the clever solution is to create this wonderful little mini landscape of alpines and succulents all grown in containers on the top here. But underneath, we've got some storage. So here we've got some terracotta pots. What's in this one? Some lovely tools in there. So there you go. It looks great, but it also functions well, which is what good design is all about. If you still think you haven't got space to do a design like this, then check out the Constraining Nature Garden. It's a tiny plot with big ideas. Just imagine this in your own back garden. It's a tiny little space, 5 metres by 4 metres, but it's got everything you want from a garden in it. And I particularly love the tones of the planting and the hard landscaping, the way they work together. So we've got these rusty tones of the steel at the back and then the water feature, but then the peonies, the foliage and the amelanchiers just tie the whole garden together. So lots of rusty browns, they might sound a little bit boring, but they can be extremely exciting in a small space like this. Hi, Monty. Here you are. You're all wrapped up in red as a gift.
Which is just as well, because this garden, which is the organ donation garden, the gift of life, does actually encapsulate a problem which you, the designer, must have faced, which is more and more show gardens are being sponsored or backed by a charity. So therefore, they have a very clear message that the designer has to go with. Is that tricky?
Well, it's tricky, but it gives you a starting point. So here you know what that message is, and you need to get that across in a garden. And here there's a heart shape, if you look at it in a plan form, and then there's a yes path and a no path and a gift in the middle.
I think what it does show that if you have a strong idea and you do it well, it'll be a good garden.
It's not a garden you're going to live with. It is a show garden, after all. It's going to come down at the end of the week, and people are going to enjoy it.
Standing here, looking out, I'm really enjoying this tulip. It's Pretty Woman. And that red is fantastic, especially when it's backlit. And I'm definitely going to order that and plant it in the jewel garden at Longmeadow next year.
It's a beauty, isn't it? And I love this planting with the random size U and the box balls. You know, that is really nicely done with a path running through it.
Well, I'm going to go and look now for bee-friendly plants.
OK.
So I'll see you later.
I think I'll just hang around here a bit longer.
Well, there's plenty of fruit if you're feeling
peckish. I might have a few grapes. Why not?
The Malvern Spring Festival. People have come from all corners of the British Isles to celebrate plants. And what's more, there's something here for everyone. Well, some people are on the lookout for something extra special. And what could be more exquisite than these magnificent peonies? A sort of alpine orchid. They come from the mountains of the Orient. And where they grow, sometimes it's on the tree branches themselves, they're epiphytic, or on the ground, but in all cases, they're dry, really, really well drained. Now, you can't really grow these outside in the UK, but what you can do is grow them in a cold greenhouse. They'll give you this beautiful show, and then gradually, during the winter, they'll die down. You withdraw all water from them, but in the spring, up will come the new shoot, where the bulb has made pseudo-bulbs. Each year, you get more and more flowers. You can hardly believe that such beautiful things are so straightforward to grow. Well, that's typical of the kind of plants you can find at Malvern. While some visitors seek out the really special and unusual, for others, it's a question of a quest for all those wonderful stalwart plants that make the backbone of our herbaceous borders and beds. This is Euphorbia epithymoides. They go so brilliantly well with other perennials. Here with this soft lilac of Polymonium lambrook mauve. What a gorgeous combination. Or be really daring and throw in some red poppies for a real retina-searing contrast. And here's another stand stacked with stalwarts. Look, there's another Polymonium here. This is Sonia's bluebell. And here in front of it, just sort of billowing forwards, is this gorgeous little sweet pea. It's Lathyrus vernus albo roseus. It doesn't climb, it just makes these neat little clumps, smothered with these dainty pink and white flowers. Well, this stand's been put together by Helen, who's exhibiting here for the very first time. Congratulations.
We got silver gilt, which I'm very, very pleased with.
And what do you think of the show so far?
It's amazing. It's amazing. There's so much to see. I'm a plantaholic, so I'm in plant heaven here.
Yeah,
it's
same here.
Brilliant.
Well, I hope we're going to be able to see you year after year, and you'll become a stalwart too.
So too.
Well, for Helen, this is her very first time at Malvern, but some of the exhibitors here have been coming for yonks. We caught up with one of the most celebrated of them, Bob Brown, at his nursery.
I started here in 1990, that's 25 years ago, and I reckon more or less I've been every year to the Malvern show, wonderful show. It is the essence of spring. Everything is starting into growth. It's about plants, and that's what I really enjoy. Before you choose plants for the show, you've got to have an idea of what objective you're aiming for. So this year it's 25 years of the nursery. So I've got no holds barred. I can take whatever I like, providing it's looking good. Look at this. Choisya White Dazzler. Wonderful perfume. Lovely shape. Never been trimmed. Maybe that's 8, maybe 10 years old. Flowers twice, so we get flower now in April, May, and we get flower again in September. Wonderful digitate foliage, like my hand. And it's really hardy. We had minus 26 centigrade in December 2010. In a pot, frozen solid, no problems. All the other choisyas died, not this one. Where would I plant it? It'll grow anywhere, even in dry shade under trees. Good for small gardens, because it's a small plant. Good for a big garden. It's a fantastic show. It's got it all. It's my favourite plant. 10 out of 10. Here's a new plant. Named it last week. It's called Anemone nemorosa frenzy. Anemone nemorosa is the wood anemone, and this mutated out of a pink one called Westwell pink. A bit improbable when you look at the colours, but there you go. How would you use a wood anemone in a garden? In a shady place, under some trees or shrubs, where it'll colonise, and it'll just give you that splash of colour early in the spring. You know, some people say you've got to travel to remote parts of the world to collect a new plant, but it's not always true. I found this on the A44, just outside Worcester, underneath a sign. It said, Droitwich, 7 miles. so I called it Droitwich. Symphytum atlanticum, Droitwich. It's a comfrey. And I enjoy the foliage, nice and bright in the spring. I just love variegation, you know, because even when there's no flower, you can enjoy the foliage. This kind of variegation is called chimeral. Chimera was a Greek mythical being that was half goat, half man. And here we have one plant inside another. And what we have is a green plant sitting inside a yellow plant. So if you take seed, the results will be all yellow. And if you were to take roots, and you can propagate a symphyton from roots, it would be entirely green. We're not doing a garden this year, we're doing a display of what it's like to be on a nursery. So we'll have compost and trolleys and pots, and plants in pots, no garden. And the idea will be to show people that this is a working nursery that produces its own plants. It would be very nice to get a gold medal or a silver gilt or a silver, be very happy with a silver medal. If it's a gold medal, it's 500 quid. We can have a party for the nursery on 500 quid, that'd be good.
So a party or not a party?
Yeah, we got our silver gilt, so enough money to have a really good party, yeah.
You've got some wonderful silvery plants on your stand, haven't you?
Yeah, 25 years. Yeah. It's Jess, who built the stand, decided to put a bit of glitter on stuff to celebrate.
And I want to say thank you for all that 25 years and for bringing all these plants to our attention.
Now, whilst, of course, it's wonderful to come and get inspiration from shows, you mustn't neglect the work in your own garden. So here are some jobs that you can be getting on with this weekend. At this time of year, herbaceous plants are growing very fast indeed. And sooner or later, they'll need support. And the secret is to give them that before they need it. I use homemade wire supports, but brushwood or twine and canes will do the job just as well. Whatever you use, make sure you hold the plant up without throttling it, so it continues to look natural. The best way of keeping on top of weeds in the vegetable garden is by using a hoe, and do this often. Always hoe in dry weather, and that way there's no risk of the weeds re-rooting and growing in damp soil. We've seen the weather veer from extreme heat to frost in just a few hours this spring already. So it's very important to harden plants off properly before planting them out. And this applies whether you've raised them yourself or bought them from a garden centre. Put the young plants in a protected place outside for at least a week before planting them into their final position. An inspirational flower-filled day here at Morven, and I do urge you to come along if you possibly can. The show is open until the end of the weekend, and you can get all the details on timings and how to get here from our website. I might have guessed you'd be boozy sitting here.
I got you one, Monty.
Thank you, bless you.
I was going to have a couple to myself, yeah. But you know.
So you've got to keep it.
Have you had a good time?
Yeah, I've had a great, really lovely day, I have to say. I love the rearrangement of the show. All the elements are here, but they've moved to everything sited, so they bring the Malvern Hills to the forefront.
And that's what makes the Malvern show, isn't it?
Yeah, it's absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. That and the plants.
Yeah, a few plants.
Yeah, you noticed some plants here, didn't you?
In the floral marquee, it's just stacked with wondrous things. I haven't actually bought anything yet, but I've got my eyes on the most beautiful clematis called Elgar, but some people haven't been so restrained, have they?
Some people haven't, they keep your mitts off. I've got a new garden, and I mean, there's
you don't need an excuse then, do you? The garden just says, buy me some plants, and I'm happy to oblige. So I've been shopping a bit. Aquilegia, Scilla, lovely clematis here. So.
Yeah, lovely.
But, you know, the thing that's given me most pleasure is this show garden. It's a beautiful recreation, brilliantly done.
Me, I feel like I'm on holiday right now.
Yeah.
Well, you might well be drinking, sitting
you are,
outside.
Aren't you?
Well, now that the show season is well and truly underway, you shouldn't forget that a new programme called The Great Chelsea Garden Challenge begins on Monday at 8 o'clock and will continue on BBC Two all next week. And, Joe, you know much more about this than me or anyone else, really.
I do. Well, I'm helping guide six amateur garden designers, but the prize is absolutely huge to build a Main Avenue Chelsea show garden this year.
So we will see that
at Chelsea. It's exciting stuff.
Well, I can't wait to see it. But that's it from Malvern this week. But I shall be back at Longmeadow and we'll see you at our normal time next week. So until then, goodbye and here's to Malvern.
To Malvern. Cheers. Malvern.
Cheers. Malvern. Cheers.